Something came from Baltimore. Something came from Baltimore.
Welcome to another edition of Something Came from Baltimore. I'm your host, Tom Galker. And tonight on the phone, we have the Hammond B3 jazz icon, Joey DeFrancesco. Joey DeFrancesco has been recording since 16 and now he's 48, and he's one of the hardest working men slash in his prime slash creating his own path slash trailblazer. Just in the last couple years, he has been on a tear. In April 2008, he collaborated with Van Morrison with You're Driving Me Crazy, a following promotional tour, and then December 2018, the second recording with Van Morrison called The Prophet Speaks. In 2019, he released The Keys to the Universe with Pharaoh Sanders. And tonight, on Something Came from Baltimore, we have the amazing Joey DeFrancesco. Thank you, Joey DeFrancesco, for talking to me on Something Came from Baltimore.
My pleasure, man.
In 2017, you recorded the project Freedom, and I thought it was a political statement in the Trump era. I felt you were reaching out to make a musical soundtrack of human struggle.
Well, in a way, I mean, you know, that was, it wasn't intentionally a political project, but I mean, you know, it delves into that a little bit because what it presents itself about just a freedom and equality, you know, for everyone. And so, yes, that would work with that. And that's the direction. That's what led us to what we're doing now, you know.
The album was a tribute to the love of Philadelphia. I lived there for 14 years, and I used to see you on a semi-regular at the Orleans Jazz House. And I used to watch you and your dad perform. It seems like that every night was different, and Bootsy Barnes would come in. And your sets with your dad were very loose, and you guys talked to the audience. It was a lot of fun.
Yeah, for sure. Well, and, you know, I never officially worked there. I would just go there and hang out and sit in and have fun with all those cats. My dad played there. Bootsy Barnes played there. I mean, Mickey Roker was the house drummer. Shirley Scott would play in there. I mean, there was always great musicians in there. So that's why I was down there. If I ever played in there, it was just for, like, for fun or for to hang out. But it was definitely a vibe, you know. And it definitely was an education being in there and seeing all the musicians together, all the cats hanging out and playing and having a good time, you know.
The parking was scary down there. It was very sketchy.
Yeah, it was a little suspect, right? They had a parking lot next door, but he didn't own that. And then it was just a lot of little quirky things, but it was a vibe, you know.
Which brings me to my next question. What is your favorite cheesesteak, Geno's or Pat's? And if I would put anything in the list, I'd say D'Alessandro's.
Well, none of those, because I don't eat meat, and I haven't for about 4 years. So
you left Philly, and you traveled the world, and now you're in Arizona. Are you happy there?
I just went out there and liked it. I like the desert, and, you know. I like the way it feels out there. It's got a great vibe, and so we visited there when I was a kid, and I decided when I was going to have my own residence, that would definitely be one of them. So that's how that happened.
Oh,
of blue. I dreamt with the friends who were near me to cheer me. Believe me, they knew. But you were the catch who would hurt me, desert me when I needed you.
How did you meet up with Van Morrison, and how did the Drive Me Crazy and Prophet Speaks come about?
He just wanted to do some recording. His people contacted mine, and he wanted to know if would you be interested in to do some recording, and that's where it started. And from there, that's what happened. We got together, talked about some music, went in a studio and recorded the first record, and did a few gigs because of that one, and then did another record like a year later.
I listened to the recording and I was a little confused at first. I thought there would be like a sharing of like leads, but once I saw a live concert on TV of you and your band, it was real obvious that you guys were, they really had a good theme for that. How were the recordings?
Yeah, well, I think that's part of the reason we did good in the studio and things. He likes to move fast. He likes things to happen fast. He's not patient. And we can work together that way, because I understand that too. I get that way too. I expect everybody to know what they're doing and be able to just do it. And so we worked well together that way. But that's okay. But, but that's music, and he loves music, and that's where our relationship is based on music. I don't know anything about his personal life.
I'm a big fan of Van Morrison, but I don't know anything personally about him.
Yeah, that's a good move. Yeah.
Are you experiencing a metaphysical, emotional, or spiritual awakening?
Well, I mean, it happens to me everywhere. And the thing is that, you know, that's just a natural, your growth in your life, your path that you take, and maturing and understanding and being in touch with your surroundings. It's the universe. And yes, there's always been a spiritual awakening as part of my life, but you don't understand it as much when you're younger. Or maybe some people do. For me, you know, I'm still maturing. I'm still learning about that. And I know that my music always had it, but when you get it in your life and how you live, it just opens the doors to a lot of other possibilities that in turn affect your music. That's exactly how it works, because those two things aren't separate. Me and my music are all one thing, and spirituality is a big part of it. And yes, that's the inspiration. It has been the inspiration. I'm just more aware of it and getting closer and getting more in touch with it.
Your wife, Gloria, is the co-producer to this record. Does she play any instruments? Is she, how involved is she in the production?
No. She just has excellent musical ears, and she understands music, all kinds. And she's in the same, we're on the same page about everything in our life. So we do everything together. And she's not only my manager, she produced the last three records. And she's also my wife, number one. And we're best friends, and we're together all the time. She's incredible. So, and things have been the best since we've been together all the way around. So, and she turned out to have excellent, I mean, this isn't something I knew right from the beginning, but her musical abilities and her ears and what sounds good and, you know, what has a flow is incredible. And I've been paying attention to that. And it makes sense. And the proof is in the pudding, so to say.
In the Keys of the Universe, in your latest recording, it celebrates the metaphysical, the cosmic jazz soundscape of the 60s and the mid-70s. You're celebrating an intense period of jazz for this album. And a younger listener, it's possible that they wouldn't even know that this was had a piece of history of it's a place marker in music. And how did that concept evolve, and how did you make it your own?
Yeah, well, it's both. You kind of nailed that. It's very fresh because it's a new perspective on that style. I mean, you know, the thing is, musicians have been doing this. Duke Ellington was doing this in the 30s. If you go back and listen to, we did not too long ago, we put on, you know, the song Come Sunday. Obviously, that's a spiritual melody. It's about Sunday and the church. And you listen to it, they're taking that. I mean, they're stretching the boundaries big time. You're talking about the 30s. So that whole concept of the spiritual aspect involving the music and stretching the harmonies, because there's no boundaries. It sounds like it's in the 30s because it is, but it's you could see how that, you know, is happening. And you're probably talking because we did Creators and Master Plan. That was done exactly 50 years ago, 1969. And I included Pharaoh Sanders on his project for obvious reasons. And Billy Hart, he was on the original on drums. And we're playing that, but it sounds nothing like the original. It captures the spirit of that, you know, but it's different. You have an organ. We don't get into so much of the sound effects that they did with the completely free, just roaring and screaming. We didn't do that, which I love too. You get into that live, but we had to condense it too. I mean, you remember that's, if you checked out the original, that's a 32 minute recording. So we got it down to 11, and even now 11 minutes is although every time I see the turn on XM radio, I hear it come on. So it's because people feel good when they hear it. It's, you can totally feel what that tune represents, you know. It's enlightening listening to that music. And I, all the tunes that I wrote, you know. That's the only one I did write on this record.
Did you know Pharaoh Sanders, and how did you get him on board? He's not recording it as much as he used to, and he does sound really great.
Pharaoh, I have never recorded with. I knew Pharaoh, and we talked about doing stuff. He sat in with me many years ago. But it never seemed to work out to get it together to do it. And now that, you know, it was just the right time. Everything lined up. You know, that's part of being in the key of the universe. Things happen when they're supposed to happen. You just pay attention to what's happening around you. And this was the situation that was just... where to have Pharaoh. It's, you know, he's like going to the source when it comes to, you know, that spiritual free style of music that's still invoking jazz and tradition. He's very certain business wise about how he wants things. If it's not going to be exactly how he wants it, he's not going to do it. That's why he hasn't recorded as a leader in some time. And, you know, it's got to be right. He's got to love the music. Everything's got to be right.
Can we talk about a couple tracks? I personally love A Path to Noise. It has a, I have a Quaker past, and it has a really great Zen vibe to it.
Mm-hmm. So try to explain that? That particular tune? Well, it's totally cool. You know, if you look at the flow of the album and the titles, they're all stories, right, about that particular thing. So A Path Through the Noise, I mean, we have, you know, some really romping a couple of fast tunes, you know, and there's all the real spacious, kind of meditative type sounds. But then through all of that, I mean, there's good noise, right? But sometimes there's a lot of other noise, and you just need a pass to get through the noise. So that's what that means, you know. It's that story of life, you know, and how you're living. And you got to get through the path. You have to make your own path through the noise sometimes. And that's what creates that. And if you listen to the peaks and valleys of the way the melody goes, and then there's the second part of the melody, then a trumpet comes in. It's all very, it's like a whisper in your ear of, you know, just to pay attention and find your path.
I also enjoy inner being.
We wound up putting it on the title of the album. I mean, the opening track. When we were listening to everything, me and Gloria, because it does, it makes a statement. This is what this is about, and you're going to hear this kind of record. This is the story. It's something new, something fresh. I mean, everything about Inner Being, the time signature, you know, there's no organ player in history that's recorded in 7/4. You know, so right away that makes it different, you know. Then all those different sounds, the layers, you know. Sure. Well, I mean, again, the title kind of says it all, and you feel that in the title, awake. You're when you hear that, you know, you're awake. Me playing it is how I feel. I feel awake and bliss, and that's how it should feel to somebody when they hear it. You know, it's the same. You know, it's the same kind of thing. And then it swung wide open. That's like, that can mean several things, but to me, it means like the door of enlightenment. You know, where however you know the bright light coming in the door. Those are the two fast ones, you know.
Is there anyone living that you want to work with?
Sure. I mean, there's a lot of people. Some of them don't play anymore. They're like Sonny Rollins doesn't play anymore. And I, of course, Roy Haynes, you know, Chick Corea. I've talked to Chick about doing like a thing with a piano, organ, and drums. Herbie. We got to play a little bit together, you know. But, you know, there's, goodness, Charles Lloyd. Love Charles Lloyd. Yeah. I mean, you know, if I think hard enough, I could probably come up with quite a few. But there's a lot of great musicians out there. And you know, I'm going to be doing some stuff with Christian McBride. You know, we went to high school together. And as well as Kurt Rosenwinkel. And so there's, you know, a lot of peers. There's some of my peers that I enjoy playing with.
So many artists, they put an album out and then they tour on it for a couple years. And in your case, you are putting out material and you're just constantly working and developing new material. What's next for you?
Well, we're going to play, you know, we have this one. We're going to tour this one, of course. That's what I'm doing for now. There is a record coming out later on this year with Christian McBride. And I got a lot of other stuff in the works. There'll be something. There always is something. I mean, I have enough material. You know, I have so many ideas that, you know, I'll get to them at different times. And they come in when I just listen to what's happening. It comes in naturally, you know.
Ladies and gentlemen, the new album is In the Key of the Universe. Thank you, Joey DeFrancesco, for joining me on Something Came from Baltimore.
Thank you, man. My pleasure.
Something came from Baltimore. Something came from Baltimore.